waging information warfare against pushers of fake news. It's David Knight.
Welcome back. Let's take a look at the news at the top of the hour. Here we have a report from Fox News talking about the violence in New York City suburbs. And, of course, that's on Long Island, where my wife grew up. Now they have, by some estimates, more than 400 MS-13 gang members. And these are people here illegally. But, of course, they can't be deported simply because they are foreign citizens trespassing illegally. And also tattooed with MS-13 all over their faces. No, that's not enough. You have to catch them in the crime before you can get rid of them, before you can deport them. And this report from Fox News is talking about a couple of parents who brought their kids here illegally, foreign citizens who are criminally trespassing, but they brought their kids to America because they wanted to get away from El Salvador and places like that where there was violence. The problem is that if you don't have legitimate borders, MS-13 can follow you across the border. And that's precisely what has happened. The people who have been butchered in the areas of New York that used to be safe, this Long Island, that used to be safe every town suburbia. Levittown was one of the first places to have the kind of suburbs where people could escape the city. They could get in their cars and they could commute, or they could commute with the railroad or whatever. They wanted to get out of the city. They wanted to have a little bit more breathing space. And that was one of the first places where you saw the suburbs, people trying to get a little bit more space, a little bit better quality of life. And it was Middletown America suburbia. But now it is becoming like Central America, the violence, the drug gangs that are there. And the people who are suffering from this are the immigrants at this point. That violence is going to spread. But they're getting hacked to death with machetes and other things, being lured into areas, killing people that they know simply because they can, because it's an initiation rite or whatever. And there's a heartrending testimony from a couple of these parents. One of them said, destroyed. I'm just destroyed. I don't have another word other than destroyed, because one brings his sons here to achieve their best, and this happens. Well, this happens because we don't have control of our borders, because we say anybody who wishes to can come here, and we don't have any say-so about it. So they can criminally trespass, they can bring drug gangs in, they can do anything that we want, and we have to just stand down because of political correctness. They cannot escape it because America is being destroyed by open borders. When they come here and the gangs follow them in, it's no longer America. Meanwhile, we look at Asia and the trip that President Trump is on. This one article here stuck out to me because it's an article about President Trump eating a cheeseburger, $10 cheeseburger. And as the Japanese people watched him, they said, we got to have that as well. So now they're selling out. They can't keep them in stock. It's now become very popular. And I remember when George H.W. Bush went to Japan on a trip, and he ate some sushi or something, and he stood up with the video cameras on him and blew lunch all over the counter. And the Japanese, who have a very good sense of humor, thought it was hilarious, and they came up with a new word for puking, and they called it bushusuru, to do a bush. So that's the legacy of George H.W. Bush. President Trump's legacy is that he's made cheeseburgers very popular, the $10 cheeseburgers very popular. And the legacy of the NFL is half-empty stadiums, while you've got the NFL commissioner who is burning down the league, burning down what used to be America's favorite sport. It's now become the least favorite of the professional teams. He is demanding that he get $49.5 million plus a private jet. And if you look at these pictures, here's one of the rivalry that has gone on for years that always would pack the stadiums between the Chicago Bears and the Green Bay Packers. Half empty. Half empty. That's what the legacy of political correctness is doing for the NFL. They will destroy their league. I think they already have, with people protesting on Veterans Day. The players are still doing it. Stay with us. We'll be right back. I'm David Knight. Welcome back. I'm David Knight on this Monday, November 13th, 2017. This last Saturday, we had an amazing thing on Saturday Night Live. It's not really news when they make fun of President Trump, but when they make fun of the Democrat Party, This is kind of a man bites dog story, right? It is such a reversal that it's actually newsworthy. And so they had a Saturday Night Live skit poking fun of the leaders of the Democrat Party, showing them as being out of touch, old losers. And they had people portraying Nancy Pelosi and Bernie Sanders and others, and they're congratulating themselves for winning a couple of elections and saying they're back. And as I pointed out, winning in New Jersey is no great achievement if you're a Democrat. It's not even an achievement if you win the gubernatorial race in Virginia as a Democrat. As I said, out of the last five races, the Democrats have won in Virginia. Four out of five times. There's only been one Republican out of the last five races. And two of those Democrats are people like Tim Kaine, the running mate of Hillary Clinton, and Terry McAuliffe, the corrupt collaborator, co-conspirator, I should say, with Hillary Clinton. If there's any justice done, that's the way he'll be remembered in history. Terry McAuliffe, the guy who went to, I think it was Mississippi, I think, where he went down and told them that they were going to do some kind of electric car company. Put together that deal, got millions from the people in Mississippi, never built a single car. You know, that con man, that crook, Terry McAuliffe, the guy who's been connected to the Clintons for decades, the guy that was their handpicked individual at the time to run the DNC. That's this current sitting governor, the guy who had some real conflict of interests issues with the number two at the FBI, Andrew McCabe, whose wife was running for office in Virginia, and Terry McAuliffe and others were being investigated by her husband at the time. So these are that's the political landscape in Virginia, and you know what it is in New Jersey. And so they're now celebrating these elderly Democrat Party people, and the Saturday Night Live is making fun of them. That's a real man bites dog story. Here's another one. Russia is considering to designating CNN and Voice of America as foreign agents. Maybe we should do the same thing with CNN. I think CNN is a foreign agent. I think they're a foreign agent of the deep state, which is this kind of parasite that is occupying the host of America. You know, it's kind of like we're the host and they're the parasitic dark state government that is actually a world government. And they basically have taken over our government. So maybe we ought to, if we ever get control of our government again, we ought to label CNN as a foreign agent of the occupying government of the United States, because that's really what they are. Voice of America, of course, going back a number of years, Voice of America, Radio Free Europe, and so forth, there was a prohibition against these organizations broadcasting in America for good reason. They are propaganda organizations. And there was the Smith-Mundt Act, which said you will not be able to broadcast in America. They had set them up as propaganda organizations. They didn't admit to the fact that they had set up ABC, NBC, and CBS as propaganda arms of the CIA with Operation Mockingbird. That eventually did come out. But most people don't really still pay any attention to that. But it was very ominous a couple of years ago when we had the federal government say, we're going to remove the prohibitions against Voice of America and Radio Free America, Radio Free Europe, or whatever, from operating in the United States. And all of us said at the time, this is not a good sign, because they are propaganda organizations. And as we were talking about Judge Roy Moore and the people who were coming out and say, these are serious allegations, and they're so serious that he should step aside, whether or not they're true, we don't have the presumption of innocence. How much have you heard about Senator Robert Menendez, who is on trial for all kinds of graft and corruption, and also includes charges, allegations of having sex with underage hookers in the Dominican Republic? Is that something that you've heard John McCain or Mitt Romney say, that he ought to be, step down because of the seriousness of these allegations? These are allegations against a Democrat senator coming from a Democrat Department of Justice, coming from a Democrat Health and Human Services Secretary, Kathleen Sebelius, saying that on behalf of a very rich and successful eye doctor in Florida, not even in his jurisdiction of New Jersey, that he had called in the HHS secretary, Sebelius, and said, you need to talk to this guy. He's owed several million dollars, and we need to get to the bottom of this, make this happen. Things like that. That really raised a lot of concerns with Democrats. Kathleen Sebelius, the Department of Justice under Obama, they are the ones who took Robert Menendez to court for corruption charges. And now, as this is going to trial, and I don't think they'll get a conviction because when they, this is a 9-week trial. How many times have you heard about this? Have you really seen this reported? How much airtime has fake news CNN devoted to this? How much airtime, how much articles and column inches has the Washington Post dedicated to this? Again, I stopped by different places where they got CNN on the television as we're walking through, and I saw nonstop coverage about Roy Moore. Have they talked at all about Senator Robert Menendez? You got federal prosecutors said they aren't convinced that claims that Senator Robert Menendez cavorted with underage hookers are false, even though they are seen as being discredited by others. The defense said that the case is bogus because it sprang from easily disprovable claims that Menendez slept with underage prostitutes while hosted by Melgen at a Dominican Republic villa. But in a motion last week, and you didn't hear about this, did you? In a motion last week, we've talked about it here on this program. We talked about it on InfoWars, but you're not going to hear it on mainstream media. You're not even going to hear Fox News talking about it, really. They said in a motion last week, the government asked the judge to ignore the defense arguments. The Justice Department lawyers say the hooker allegations, quote, were not so easily disprovable as defendants suggest. The prosecutors say their investigation resulted from specific, quote, specific corroborated allegations that defendants Menendez and Melgen had sex with underage prostitutes in the Dominican Republic. The prosecutors noted there was eyewitness testimony that Melgen, 61, attended a party that included prostitutes and that he flew, quote, numerous young women to the Dominican Republic on his private jet. There are financial allegations. There are allegations of underage prostitutes, and yet no calls for him to step down. And no publicity of this. You don't see gavel-to-gavel coverage of the trial. You didn't even know there was a trial, probably. If you listened to mainstream media, you wouldn't know that. And you wouldn't know if you didn't listen to us. Actually, Drudge had the article up. The fact that after 9 weeks, when the jury goes out to make a decision, one of the jurors asked the judge to explain to him what a senator is. That should tell you something about the chances for getting a conviction on this. So there's a difference between not guilty and being innocent. And we're going to see that come out here. But I think that is exactly what we're talking about here. The bias of the media. The fact that you cannot turn on any of the mainstream media, even Fox News, without getting round-the-clock coverage about an allegation 40-year-old incident with Roy Moore, and yet nobody will talk about Robert Menendez. Nobody in the Republican establishment is saying that he needs to step down. But they use every pretense to try to put somebody else in who has been an abject failure in the run-up to this election. Even when they do a poll and say, well, what about if we put him in as a write-in? Even there, he only gets 12% of the vote. But the key is that keeps Roy Moore out of the Senate. And that's what Mitch McConnell and the rest of them want. They don't want somebody in who will shut down his political career over principle. And that's the man they tell us we can't believe. No, we have to believe the people who never said anything until he ran for Senate. Stay with us. We'll be right back. I'm David Knight. Welcome back. I'm David Knight, and we're going to be talking about the Podestas. It seems like there is nowhere to run and nowhere to hide for them. They're getting caught up. Maybe they're going to be the sacrificial lambs, as Alex Jones and InfoWars has predicted. They'll be the sacrificial lambs, the fire that stops the fire, that the backfire that stops this consummation of the Democrats. You know, we've talked many times about how the American public and the mainstream media seems to have the ability to only focus on a single story at a time. And that's basically true, except for the Russian hack story. That just goes and goes and goes. It's the ever-ready bunny of conspiracy theories that just keeps going. And it just keeps delivering for these people, doesn't it? So we're going to take a look at what's going on with the Podesta group. We're also going to take a look at the comments that President Trump made after meeting with Putin, calling people like James Clapper. I mean, who would ever call people like James Clapper and John Brennan and Comey? Who would ever call them political hacks? That's exactly what they are. As a matter of fact, somebody sent a thing to me and they said, you know, maybe we're looking at Donna Brazile's book that she called Hacked. Maybe we're looking at that the wrong way. Maybe what she's doing is calling the Democrats hacks. Well, that's what they are, but I don't think that's exactly what she's doing there. Before we get to the news, I want to just remind you of the sales we still have from our 34-hour broadcast that we did last week. American Rebirth and Renaissance, after the one-year anniversary of President Trump's election. We have a wide variety of products that are discounted 50% off with free shipping. Just think about it as the number of tweets that were suppressed by Twitter in order to help the Democrat Party to suppress all those hashtag DNC leaks so that they could shut down the information that was actually came out to expose these people while they could push their phony Russian collusion narrative. That they still don't have any evidence for. But here's some of the 50% off of our products, our popular products here. Super Male Vitality, 50% off for free shipping, and Super Female Vitality. Biome Defense, that is our probiotic strains that you can use to increase your gut health. That is 50% off for free shipping. All T-shirts and caps, all apparel, 50% off with free shipping at InfoWarsStore.com. Also, Secret 12, our vitamin B12 formula, that is 50% off. Vitamin Mineral Fusion Drink Mix, a great way to take your baseline vitamins and minerals without having to swallow a lot of pills. Vitamin Mineral Fusion Drink Mix is now 50% off with free shipping. And DNA Force is now back in stock, 25% off with free shipping. Take a look at the specials. Take a look at the reviews that you'll find on InfoWarsStore.com. They're curated by a third party, so we don't have anything to do with those. But you can see what other people say about these products. And if you haven't tried them, now is a great time to try them as they're 50% off with free shipping. Let's take a look at what's going on with the Podestas. A story over the weekend from Jamie White, Kit Daniels. Podestas are now facing an indictment, say sources. Tony and John Podesta are facing criminal indictments linked to the ongoing Russian probe. Sources tell InfoWars that Tony Podesta in particular was told to prepare for indictments because Special Prosecutor Robert Mueller's entire case against former Trump campaign chair Paul Manafort goes through Podesta, and evidence suggests that Podesta has done everything that Manafort is accused of doing, if not more. The Podestas might be used as sacrificial lambs for the Democrat Party, said Alex Jones, who is briefed by sources close to the matter. And of course, we were saying this all through the campaign. We're saying, look at the fact that he was a lobbyist for exactly the same people. So you had, at the time that Paul Manafort was Trump's campaign manager, John Podesta was Hillary Clinton's campaign manager. And says, why are they making an issue out of Paul Manafort's associations here when John Podesta's K Street group was working for exactly the same people in the Ukraine and elsewhere? And, of course, Trump fired Manafort, but Hillary Clinton kept John Podesta. Ah, that's the difference. That's the difference. So that's the story that won't go away, is the story about Russia. And as Zero Hedge points out, the person who used to be head of the Podesta Group, she was the chief executive of Podesta Group, Kimberly Fritz, told employees last Thursday that the firm would not exist by the end of the year and that they would likely not be paid through the end of November. She announced her resignation from the Washington lobbying group after Podesta, Tony Podesta, left the company amid ties to indictments that were filed in the Russian investigation. So it is coming down. The company is coming down. But let's take a look at the basis of all this. And what have we learned in the last couple of weeks that is really significant? As they continue, as we see Robert Mueller never giving up on this special prosecutor investigation, even though there is no legal basis for having a special prosecutor, that law expired 18 years ago. It was a bad law. The Congress did not reauthorize that law, but at least that law had some oversight capability, which is not there at all in this particular investigation. If he was going to expand it, taking it in a different direction, he had to get the authorization of the Attorney General. He had to report to a three-judge panel. The special prosecutor was to be appointed by a three-judge panel, not by the Attorney General or the person who was acting Attorney General. But as we pointed out before, the fact that the Manafort search warrant and this investigation may have been built on the fake dossier is a key issue. And the Washington Examiner, Brian York, is saying, did the dossier trigger the Trump-Russia probe? Understand how important this question is. Because if it was a dossier that we have now learned was funded by Hillary Clinton and the Democrat Party that she bought, and then they used their lawyer to buy a filthy fiction tale from a British spy, Christopher Steele. The whole thing was a fabrication. The whole thing was bought and paid for by Hillary Clinton. And then that became the basis for the Trump-Russia probe. If that is true, then everything about this collapses. If that is true, the search warrant, which we know they use the dirty dossier as a basis to get a search warrant against Paul Manafort. The legal principle here, as we've explained before, is if the tree is poison, in other words, if the investigation, if the search warrant is based on a poisonous tree, a false allegation or a concocted allegation that was written by the opposition to Donald Trump, if it's based on that poison tree, then the fruit of any of that investigation is also poisonous and cannot be admitted. And then to that, you have to add the information about Uranium One, the fact that you had Mueller and Comey colluding with the Democrats to obscure what happened with Uranium One, to gag the witness so that he could not speak during the 2016 election. All of that, if we look at that, and the fact that the special prosecutor, if there was any ethics at all involved in this, would recuse himself for the mere appearance of impropriety after what we have now learned about Uranium One. But the revelations that we've had in just the last month about this witness who had a non-disclosure agreement put on him, that he was gagged, that he was threatened not to say that the FBI knew that this was a corrupt purchase with Uranium One. They conspired to conceal that, to cover that up, as well as the phony basis for all of this, that should bring this investigation down. Stay with us. I'm David Knight. We'll be right back. Welcome back. I want to take a look in this segment, not only at the people that President Trump has correctly called political hacks. That would be people like James Clapper, former FBI Director James Comey, former CIA Director John Brennan. Those people are definitely hacks. As a matter of fact, I think that is the most dangerous thing that we've seen out of this last election cycle. The fact that these people with so much power, so much unchecked power, there's absolutely no oversight of these people. We're not allowed to know anything that they do. Anybody, even within the Congress or the Senate, who has the audacity to ask for information from the CIA, as Dianne Feinstein learned, gets spied on by the CIA. Because they wanted some information about what the CIA was doing. So these are people, this is the true dark government. And as I said before, we ought to understand that they are the occupying government and CNN is their representative. We ought to register CNN and the Washington Post with their ties to the CIA. But it's absolutely true. And we've had, as President Trump met with Vladimir Putin, he said, well, he said that he didn't do it. And I believe him because these other people are political hacks. What does it say to you that the credibility, the veracity of Vladimir Putin is higher than the people who are running our national intelligence services? President Trump knows that. And it's high time that the American people understand this. Besides just the Trump voters, we see how they're politicized. We see how they're trying to operate a coup. But we have to understand how dangerous this is. The Democrats should be concerned about this as well, because it is possible that these same people could turn against the Democrats. Not likely, because they continue to push the New World Order, the globalist state, and that's essentially why this keeps going. The people at the top, both Republican and Democrat, are allowed to stay there because they support this parasite that has taken over the American government. And I think one of the things that's interesting is the arrest of Prince Bandar in Saudi Arabia, the man who has been a part of the intelligence operations, another criminal there, like Comey, Brennan, and Clapper. And I call these people criminals because they violated the Constitution. A person who is not a political hack is William Binney and the other NSA whistleblowers who put their lives as well as their honor and their careers on the line and lost that, lost their careers. They kept their honor, but they lost their careers. And Thomas Drake nearly went to prison on trumped up charges from the NSA. But they were trying to warn us what was happening. And William Binney has gone to current CIA Director Pompeo, telling him this was not a Russian hack with the DNC leaks. He is the former global technical head of the NSA. He knows what is possible and what isn't possible. He made a technical case to the director of the CIA, telling him that this is a lie that is being sold by John Brennan and others that continue to insist that it was all 17 agencies. And we continue to see that narrative pushed by CNN and not pushed back even by conservative media like Fox. They will not push back against this. You have to understand it was completely political. And as I said before, when Megyn Kelly came here, what do you think about my interview with Megyn Kelly, with Vladimir Putin? I said, I'm not concerned about Vladimir Putin. He is not the clear and present danger that this politicized surveillance state presents to the U.S. And I'm really glad to see President Trump call them out on it and say it wasn't 17 agencies that said all of this. We're going to take some calls. If you want to jump in on this and talk about what's going on in Saudi Arabia, talk about what's going on with the Mueller investigation, or Roy Moore, you can call in at 888-201-2244. Again, that's 888-201-2244. You know, one of the other things that has come out of this, and as I mentioned before, if this is all built on the phony dossier that was funded by Hillary Clinton and the Democrat Party that she bought, if it's built on that, this whole thing is a house of cards. And it is a Kevin Spacey kind of house of cards. This whole thing is going to come down. And it appears to be that that's the case. The important things that we've seen in the last couple of months is A, that the Democrats funded the dirty dossier, and B, the revelations about this eyewitness, which shows collusion and it shows obstruction on the part of the people who are running the Russian investigation. Now, one of the things that has come out was we saw George Papadopoulos, or as I guess we could call him Gilligan Papadopoulos, because now we've got this mysterious person, professor, and he even has a Marianne. I guess they're trying to get the billionaire and his wife. But the New York Times even points out that this London meeting that came up, now we have a name for this mysterious professor, the professor that came out. And they say it was March 24th, 2016, an improbable group gathered in a London cafe. George Papadopoulos, a 28-year-old from Chicago with an inflated resume. Yes, this is a guy who had lied about everything on his resume, had inflated his resume everywhere. And guess what? He meets a guy in London, the professor, who was exactly the same way. You had former ambassadors say that this guy was essentially a con man. And so these two guys are telling each other, one of them says, hey, I'm inside with Trump. And the other guy says, well, I'm inside with Vladimir Putin. Even introduced this young woman who was with him as the niece of Vladimir Putin. She had nothing at all. She knew absolutely nothing about politics. She knew very little English. But this guy kind of brings her along and misrepresents her as the niece of Putin. So these two guys are trying to con each other. And now you've got Papadopoulos, basically Mueller bought into it, put a wire on him, this particular guy. I mean, this is kind of comical to a degree, but it's not actually. Meanwhile, we see the New York Times say a serial leak of the agency's cyber weapons has damaged morale in the NSA. So these are the people that we're supposed to believe that they know everything that happened. And they say that it was all 17 agencies. And, you know, that would include, like, the Coast Guard's intelligence agency and so forth and so on. That didn't happen. What we know happened was that after Hillary Clinton said it was all 17 agencies, that was the first time we heard that, James Clapper, the political hack, had a meeting between himself, director of national intelligence, and three handpicked political operatives from the FBI, the CIA, and the NSA. And he told them what CrowdStrike, the Democrat contractor, had told the intelligence agencies. Yes, we were hacked. And we know it was the Russians. And no, you cannot have the servers or do any forensic evidence on this. Not going to allow it. And so Clapper comes in and tells these political appointees what their conclusions have been given to them by the Democrat contractor CrowdSource. And they agree. And on the basis of that, Clapper comes out and repeats the line of Hillary Clinton verbatim, saying all 17 intelligence agencies. And CNN and the rest of them said, that's the story, and we're going to stick with it. Now, at the same time, we take a look at what's happening. Of course, this is the Vault 7 information that originally came out. We had WikiLeaks give us the owner's manual so that we could understand that, yes, they are capable of spoofing a hack from any of the usual suspects, and that would be Russia, China, North Korea, Iran. They could make it appear that it was coming from those places. So when they talk about there being fingerprints, digital fingerprints, that is something that they can do very easily. And then they had a group called the Shadow Brokers who were actually putting out the code that was doing this. WikiLeaks didn't put out the code initially. And Shadow Brokers was putting it out there. And in the wake of this, what have we had? Well, we've had situations where millions of people, as I point out, have seen their computers shut down by ransomware. This is a story from the New York Times. With demands for payment and digital currency in order to have their access restored. We've had tens of thousands of employees at the maker of Oreo cookies have all their data completely wiped out. Federal Express reported that they had an attack on a European subsidiary that halted deliveries and cost them $300 million. We had hospitals in Pennsylvania, Britain, and Indonesia had to turn away patients. Why? Because we had these intelligence agencies in the United States, for which we have absolutely no oversight. We don't know what they're doing. We're not allowed to know any of that. Nobody in Congress is allowed to know that. And they didn't keep control of this, and they have unleashed cyber havoc on everyone. And yet, they're going to use that to push for more power. Welcome back. I'm David Knight. We're going to talk to our callers here. They're queued up. We've got Jesse, Jason, Brad. Hang on there. I'm going to get to you in just one moment. Real quickly, I want to tell you about the sales that we still have from our 34-hour broadcast special last week, part of the one-year anniversary celebration of Trump's election, and I would add Hillary Clinton's defeat. That it was as important to defeat Hillary Clinton and the GOP Democrat establishment as it was to elect President Trump, quite frankly. It was a win-win situation, if you want to put it that way. And another win-win situation are the products that you can use to support your health, to support the health of your family, and to fund a free and independent media. These are the products that we sell here, and as part of that celebration, we put several of them on a discount of 50% off, half price, and also added free shipping. Here's some of the products we have 50% off with free shipping. Super Male and Super Female Vitality, Biome Defense, our probiotic formula, all apparel, all t-shirts, all caps, all this, 50% off with free shipping. Also, Vitamin Mineral Fusion Drink Mix, a great way to take your baseline vitamins and minerals without swallowing handfuls of pills. And it's something that it tastes great just adding water, but you can, of course, make it taste like anything you want. Just add some fruit juice, whatever your preference is, or make a smoothie out of it. Also, Secret 12, a great way to take vitamin B12 without injections, just doing it orally. Again, that's Secret 12, our vitamin B12 formula, 50% off with free shipping. Also, we have DNA Force now back in stock. It is 25% off with free shipping. Many sales that we have at InfoWarsStore.com, and we really do appreciate your support. Let's go to our callers now. Let's go to Jesse in Virginia. You wanted to talk about the Russian investigation. Go ahead, Jesse.
Hey, how you doing, David, man? Love your show.
Doing good. Thank you.
Yep. Hey, not a problem. Hey, I was just thinking about this. I know, you always hear about Russia, this witch hunt that just never seems to end, but you always hear that's right. The taxpayer dollars are funding this, but yet Hillary Clinton purchased and bought off her DNC. She also paid off when you bought the supposed dossier and all of that. Well, I think she needs to pay for this complete witch hunt that supposedly the taxpayer dollars are paying for all of this. I mean, it's a joke.
It would be good if there were some fines that would be levied on this. I just don't know, though. You know, Jesse, when I look at this, what do you think? My concern is that as we see that Mueller and Comey and even Rosenstein were involved in this Uranium One cover-up. I mean, being the skeptical, distrustful person that I am, I look at this and say, are these guys running this investigation? Are they running the paper shredders as well so they can cover up their crimes? Because that appears to be what the real issue is here.
It's a complete cover-up, completely.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I'd like to know exactly from start to finish of this witch hunt, how much has all of this costed? Regardless if we would all love to see the, you know, Clinton campaign and all them pay for this, how much of this do you think from start to finish? And it's still ongoing.
Has this that's a key thing. You know, when you look at this, I don't know that we're going to have any accounting of it, because the thing that troubles me is the fact that we had a special prosecutor law. It was created in 1978. It had a sunset on it. It expired in 1999. People said, we don't think this is a good idea. And it went to the Supreme Court. Supreme Court ruled 8-1. Yeah, we're going to do it. We say it's constitutional. Scalia was the one person who said, I don't think this is something we want to do here, because it's going to turn into a witch hunt. It's going to turn into an investigation, not of a crime, but of individuals, because they become political targets. And we saw that happen in the intervening years. So when it got to 1999, the Congress said, no, we don't want this anymore. So there is no law to run this investigation. And we've got Attorney General Sessions allowing this to happen without any kind of oversight. There is no law and there is no oversight. As I mentioned before, there were things that would be done, oversight, where they would have to file reports to say, this is what we have done. I mean, we're not getting any reports like that that are being made public. They don't have anybody that they're reporting to. So I don't think we're going to get any financial information, any financial reports about this.
It's unfortunate.
Yeah.
It's very unfortunate. I really would like to see Jeff Sessions. You know, if there's things going on behind closed doors, David, you know, that's great. But I think we need to start shedding the light and letting the people know, because that's what Trump campaigned on was, you know, lock her up and law and order and justice for
Absolutely.
All. And, you know.
Well, you know, I've had Ty Clevenger on a couple of times, and he's trying to get information, you know, running FOIA requests, just like Judicial Watch is doing, things like that. But Ty is also trying to get some of these people like Hillary Clinton and James Comey disbarred, because Comey lied under oath. And he should be disbarred, just like Bill Clinton was disbarred for lying under oath about something that wasn't a crime. You know, he was ashamed of the fact that he had this relationship with Monica Lewinsky, so he lied about it. But the relationship was consensual. It was not a crime at the time, but they got him for perjury, and they disbarred Bill Clinton. So Hillary Clinton should be disbarred. Comey should be disbarred. But none of that is happening. And so you can't touch these people at all. But the other thing that concerns me, Jesse, is the fact that this is a special prosecutor and a special prosecution that is happening with no oversight and with no legal authority. And it reminds me of what's going on now with Attorney General Sessions and saying, you know, I'm going to try to shut down legalization of marijuana in these other states. And it's like, you don't have any authority for that. First of all, there's a 9th and 10th Amendment, which makes it clear that he has no authority for that. But where is his authority for prohibiting marijuana in the first place? We had constitutional amendment number 18 to prohibit alcohol, because 100 years ago we had people who actually respected the Constitution. There's no respect for the Constitution. There's no respect for the rule of law. And that's really sad to see that with Attorney General Sessions.
It is. It really is. Absolutely. I think the war on marijuana is just a complete joke. I mean, you see where it's gotten us now. It's gotten us nowhere. It's gotten us even worse than so many different aspects of it. And
but, you know, when you look at situations like this, it's like we're talking with Ty Clevenger. He says it's very important for us to hold these people to a standard of law. We have written laws. And so there was a written law. If you wanted to prohibit alcohol, there was nothing in the Constitution that gave them that power. They had to amend it for that specific purpose. As a matter of fact, the 9th and 10th Amendment says if we haven't explicitly given it to you, you don't have that power. But then they make everything illegal unless they expressly permit it. That's the way they have turned the Constitution on its head. And so it's not any surprise that they would take this same idea and use it for an illegal special prosecution, is it, Jesse?
You're absolutely right, David. I'm just tired of seeing all this do as I say, not as I do type deal. I come from an employer treating me like crap. I'm a former UPS employee, and that's what they did all day long with do as I say, not as I do. You do the right things. You still don't do right. And then there you turn your back, turn around. There's your management doing the same exact thing that they're, you know, punishing or disciplining you for.
And that's what we saw with Hillary Clinton, where she's violating the most the highest level national security secrets. And the director of the FBI says, we're going to let her go. But don't you try this at home. And then immediately they turn around and throw in jail a guy who is a sailor on a sub. And he took some pictures of his bunk on his phone. And those are confidential, the lowest level that you can have. They put him in prison. That's the thing that makes us so angry, that double standard that they have. The fact that nothing that Hillary Clinton or her cronies, people like Robert Mueller or James Comey, nothing these people do can ever rise to the level of criminal activity. But the most minor things that we do, they have very harsh, draconian penalties for them, don't they?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. It's the era, it's the generation of hypocrisy.
That's right. That's right. Well, thank you, Jesse. And you're talking about, will we ever know what the cost of this Russian investigation is? I mean, they seem to now only have discovered that we had Barack Obama running the national deficit up $1 to $1.5 trillion a year. And now they're using that as the basis for saying we can't have any tax relief because the Congressional Budget Office has run these numbers through. And in their opinion, they have projected that we would have an increase in the deficit of $1.5 trillion over 10 years. We had that every single year under Obama. He ran us from a $10 trillion debt to a $20 trillion debt. All right, we got about a minute and a half, and we can carry you over through the break. Let's go to Jason in Ohio. What do you think about this tax reform issue, Jason?
Well, I think they better get something done, for one. For two, I'm very aggravated with the cost of this investigation over nothing. Yes. I'm in a sort of a bad way. I trying to get disability. I have paid my taxes for 36 of my 50 years, and now that I'm down and out, I can't seem to get any answers. I can't get any help. So I wonder how they justify spending millions of dollars for nothing when there's American people out here that need help.
That's right. That's right. And that's one of the things that many people like Rand Paul have said, why are we spending so much money trying to conquer foreign countries when we don't, we've got a decaying infrastructure here. We got people who need help here in America. Why can't we look after our own first? And they come back and say, you're a dangerous Nazi nationalist when you say stuff like that. Hang on, we'll be right back. Thank you, Jason. I'm David Knight.